Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Christ by highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord. Great in time, behold Him come, offspring. Thank you. a thrill of hope. The weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees, oh, such beautiful Christmas songs, and you know, I know that it's hard to really do them justice because they're done by like the Philharmonic Symphony Orchestra, but I just appreciate all these guys just jumping up and doing these, and they're always wonderful to do, you know, singing carols and remembering the traditional Christmas songs. So it's another good one too. Angels we have heard on high sweetly singing o'er the plains and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strains. Because we cut some of the verses out, but these are really, really great songs. So I think we will just let the service continue. We got Feliz Navidad coming up at the end, and we could sing it now. You guys want to sing it? This is a family affair. Let's do it. You ready to do it? All right, stand up. What key do we do that in? Oh, let's see. Yeah, we did do it in C. All right, we're singing in C. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Espero año y felicidad. Feliz Navidad. Espero año y felicidad. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom of my heart. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Prospero año y felicidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Prospero año y felicidad. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom of my heart. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom of my heart. All right, we'll have fun. We'll do that on the outgo. But anyway, come on up, Brother Ken. All right, thank y'all so much.
Amen. Hey, Christmas songs are so fun, aren't they? Amen, amen. Boy, that was so good. Amen. Well, good morning, Grace Community Church. Welcome, everybody. I see all them smiling faces out there. Oh, they got us fired up. I saw everybody out there dancing and doing their thing. Everybody is wishing everybody a Merry Christmas from the bottom of their hearts. It was awesome. That was so good. Lots of fun. What I love about us, y'all, we love to celebrate. We love to celebrate Jesus. You know, God is such an awesome God. It's so good to see our pastor and first lady back this Sunday morning. Amen, amen. We really miss you guys. We know y'all had an awesome time, you know, but it's so good to see you guys back today. Amen, amen. Well, we've had a, catch your breath, Ken. I'm getting excited. All right, all right. I forgot to welcome our guests online. We thank you guys for being with us as well, and we hope that you guys are enjoying our service thus far and have been as blessed as we have been. Wishing everybody a Merry Christmas. Amen. Amen. Well, we have a few announcements. This one right here, no service on Christmas Day. We are celebrating Christmas Eve service here at, what time is our service? At 5? At 5. Full complete service. So come on out. Here we go. Our Christmas Eve service at 5. And y'all, it's going to be a great celebration. Y'all come on out, have an awesome time of celebrating Jesus. And then again on Sunday morning, we'll be celebrating with our families, still celebrating Jesus, amen? Having an awesome time with family, doing our what we love to do. And Dorothy and I, every Christmas morning, we go out and deliver Meals on Wheels with MIFA. We've been doing that now for about 8 years. It's an awesome thing to do. And we see a lot of our brothers and sisters in Christ that we know from different churches come. Sam Gentry and his family and a lot of them that come and they do this thing. It's an awesome time. And I'd like to invite any of you that want to go out with us. Come on and do that thing, okay? And then on Wednesday night, our family gathering from 6 p.m. to 7 p.m., we do a meal. Because we do what? We love to eat. Right? We love to eat. And then from 7 to 8 o'clock, we have a Bible study time, and we have children's church and a nursery provided for the kids. And so come on out and be a part of that this coming Wednesday. And now it is time to do our Lent. So who do we have this morning? Advent. What did I say, Lent? Advent. Thank you. Thank you. See what happened when you don't have words to go with things? Okay, my bad. Here we go.
It says the Advent wreath is a circle. It has no beginning and no end, a symbol of endless love and faithfulness. Out of the darkness, light shines, pointing us in hope to the one who came to overcome the darkness of the world and to be our light in the world to come. Today, we are relighting the candles of faith, hope, and joy. On the fourth Sunday of Advent, we light the last candle. It is called the peace candle, or the angel's candle. It is the symbol of the message of the angels, peace on earth, goodwill toward men. It reminds us of the hope fulfilled in the first coming of our Savior, and our continuing hope as we anticipate his coming again.
Let us pray. Dear God, in the fullness of time, you sent the one promised. You have given us a living hope by raising him from the dead. Enliven our hope as we live in the expectation of your coming again. We ask that this Christmas you give us full blessing of the hope and peace that Jesus Christ promised. Amen.
Amen. Sometimes we just don't believe God is as good as he is. And sometimes we don't think that we think we really need to do something extraordinarily amazing, that he would really do it. So sometimes we're just too afraid to ask God to do something that seems so large it wouldn't do any good to ask. So there was a king in Jerusalem about 750 years before Jesus was born named Ahaz. He was a real slime ball. The Jews had a bunch of them, one right after another for a long time. And this worthless king, Ahaz, I mean, he was a sinner, but not just like in the sense like we all fall short and all. He was a big time practicing sinner, big time. We don't even want to talk about it together. But God, who is a loving God, and he's always reaching out to sinners to call them to believe in him. And he's really, really good God. And he wants to bring people like him and all of us to himself. And so God sends the prophet Isaiah to King Ahaz. And look, God tells him that God is going to give him the opportunity of a lifetime. I mean, this undeserving, just like the rest of us, but real obvious there, that God is going to give him the just, I mean, incredible blank check. And so he says, go to King Ahaz and tell him to ask for anything, that it can't be too big. You know, there's just, you can't think of anything. Just ask for a sign, the biggest thing you can think of. In Isaiah 7:11, it says, ask the Lord your God for a sign of confirmation, Ahaz. Make it as difficult as you want, as high as heaven, or as deep as the place of the dead. Go for it, Ahaz. Go big. It can't get too big right now. God's given you that chance to just call on him and let him demonstrate what he can do and what he will do. But look at what King Ahaz says in 7:12. He says, but the king refused. He said, no, he said, I will not test the Lord like that. So Ahaz has these two kings coming after his country. And we won't go into a lot of detail about all that, but I mean, he could really use some help right now. And he could really use God's hand. And he just says, no, you know, I wouldn't test the Lord like that. Of course, we know he's just fronting, you know, he's just acting like that he's too holy and all that. And so Isaiah just, you know, just loses it with him just about. I mean, you know, you'd think, you know, Ahaz would say, well, I mean, I'll at least get a couple $1,000,000 or something. But I mean, you know, he says, no, I wouldn't test the Lord like that. And so God's going to give him the most outrageous thing anybody could ever dream up. Look at this. And so God says, look, I'm going to give you a sign, Isaiah, and I want you to tell him this. So He says in Isaiah 7:14, he says, "All right then, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Look, the virgin will conceive a child." Somebody who, a virgin, we're going to have a virgin birth, and she'll give birth to a son and call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. If you can't think of anything that you want God to do, if you can't think of any sign, I'm going to give you one. So God says, this is going to be something that the whole world will talk about for thousands of years. So God always keeps his promises, but he doesn't always do them on our timetable. So fast forward about 750 years. And so we see that in Matthew 1, 18 through 25, and we read the fulfillment of this promise that God gave to his people. You know, the amazing thing about the Jewish people is that they are a living testament right here in front of the whole world that God is who he says he is. You know, God chose this insignificant little group of people, and he started about 2,000 years before that to tell them, but before the coming of Christ, he tells one man, he says, "I'm going to make of you a great nation, and through you all the people of the earth will be blessed." And so God began to call this nation to himself to make for his own special people, and that God would demonstrate to the world his love for the world. He said, "I'm going to bless you and bless all the nations of the world through you." And so we see it played out through 2,000 years of history. And now this is coming to pass, that the Messiah is coming. And the story is so simple, y'all. It's so clear that I just want to read it to you. But it's, you know, usually when people are lying about something, they put a whole lot of extra words in something to try to make it sound real. I mean, really, one of the ways they tell where people are lying or not is how many words it takes to try to explain it. But look at the simplicity of this. In Matthew 1, 18 through 25, he says, "Now, this is how Jesus the Messiah was born. His mother Mary was engaged to be married to Joseph. But before the marriage took place, while she was still a virgin, she became pregnant through the power of the Holy Spirit. Joseph, to whom she was engaged, was a righteous man and did not want to disgrace her publicly, so he decided to break the engagement quietly. As he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. 'Joseph, son of David,' the angel said, 'do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child within her was conceived by the Holy Spirit, and she will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins.' All of this occurred to fulfill the Lord's message through his prophet: 'Look, the virgin will conceive a child, she will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel,' which means God is with us. And when Joseph woke up, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded, and took Mary as his wife. But he did not have sexual relations with her until her son was born, and Joseph named him Jesus." And we see, you know, the word Messiah there. It says Jesus the Messiah. Whether you're saying Jesus the Messiah or Jesus Christ, you're saying the same thing. Our English word Messiah comes from a Hebrew side of it, and our English word Christ comes from the Greek side of it, but it's the same thing. It means anointed one. Nobody was ever on this planet who was anointed like that one. Amen. Nobody. Amen. And that's why we still talk about him 2,000 years later. But he was here on this earth, and people saw it. We were just in some of those places, y'all, where he did those miracles, and to be right there in that spot where people are still talking about this 2,000 years ago, and it was right in that place Jesus showed up in history at a real place. And Christianity, y'all, can be verified and looked at and studied. The whole Judeo-Christian faith is a historical faith with evidence about it, unlike so many, just about all the other religions of the world. We don't like to call this even a religion, but you know, just for the sake of argument. It says, but before the marriage took place, while she was still a virgin, she became pregnant through the power of the Holy Spirit. So it was a virgin birth. And y'all, of course, there's so much mystery here. We'll never fully understand it. But a true virgin birth was the only way for Christ to be fully human, but also to be fully God. See, God needed to be a human to come here and to be one of us. He didn't need a man physically involved in the birth process. He didn't want a man to mess things up. You know, so I know there's a lot of women thinking about, you know, a lot of wives saying, I know that's true. But y'all be gentle on your husband now. Let him think he's actually helping. You know, that's what my wife does. You know. But anyway, God didn't want a man to be involved in this. And really, any human being wasn't really, other than the fact that he borrowed Mary's womb. You know, so Mary had to be made pregnant by the Holy Spirit. Y'all, if Jesus would have been born through a man and a woman, he would have been only human. This way he could be fully God and fully man. It says, for the child within her was conceived by the humans, by the Holy Spirit. See, no human being played any part in the conception of Jesus. And she had to give permission. Remember that? She had to, God didn't force it on her, but God knew she was be willing because he knew her faithfulness. And y'all think about this. See, God wanted his son to be raised in just the right family. That was a poor family. Right. A poor peasant family. See, we've bought into the lie that you got to have wealth to have a good family. You know, that you got to have money and wealth and all to have everything. But see, one thing that the Bible teaches about Christmas is that it's not about things. You know, it's not about getting things. And we love to give gifts and all that, and there's nothing wrong with that. But y'all, that Jesus was raised in a peasant family, a poor family. Y'all, he was raised where there would be love in the household. He was raised where God would be honored and where he would be raised up in a home like that. And God was far more concerned with things like that than giving him a home where, you know, he'd be raised in wealth and splendor and all that. And nothing wrong with that. If God blesses you with it, praise God for it, enjoy it, and just make sure you share it around. But we don't need nearly as much as we think we do. But there was plenty of love for Jesus to be raised in the home of Joseph and Mary. And look, it says, you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. His name basically meant Savior. That's what Jesus, that's what that word means. It means Savior. And there, you know, there are many who claim to be Saviors. And there are many things that we could be saved from. But the most dangerous one of them all is sin. And the sin, what we need to be saved from is sin. And that's what he said. He will save his people from their sin. Sin carries eternal danger. You know, some of these other dangers, you know, they just last for a while or something. But sin is eternally dangerous. And so the greatest danger in the world is what Jesus came to deliver us from. He says, all of this was occurred to fulfill the Lord's message through his prophet. And there it is. Look, the virgin will conceive a child. She will give birth to a son. And they will call his name Emmanuel, which is God with us. Y'all, think about that promise made, y'all. It was the greatest promise that ever been made to the human race, and it was made to a wicked king. Now, that just doesn't make any sense to me. You know, he took that promise and made it to that king of all people. And we're the beneficiaries of that today. But so Joseph took Mary, and they all they lived together and raised their son. And y'all, and God didn't want us to know everything that happened between then and the time that he was ready to begin his public ministry. But I want to look at four aspects of Jesus being in the world with his people, of him being God with us. And so number one, Emmanuel, God with us, is he keeps us strong in the faith. Y'all, he keeps us, we don't keep ourselves. Most people think it's about, you know, keeping more rules and things like that that keeps us. But what keeps us is what he tells us right here. It's extremely important for us to cooperate with God now. I'm not saying that, but it's extremely important. A strong faith just doesn't happen. But look at this verse right here about what God is doing in us before we ever put any effort into it. In Ephesians 3:17, it says, then Christ will make his home in your hearts. Your roots will grow down into God's love and keep you strong. See, this verse is in the context of what the Spirit of God is doing to open up our hearts and minds to what we have in Christ. Y'all, and so he's opening our understanding. And then he says that then as we open ourselves to God, you know, then God will make his home in our hearts. See, here's the thing about this, y'all. We can't just devote just a few short minutes to God every day. And for this to really take place, for him to make his home in our heart. Y'all, we can't say that, you know, God, I got 10 minutes before I need to get out the door this morning. And you know, then I've got my Spotify list I'm going to have on the radio. And then I've got stuff that, you know, I got to watch tonight because it's Thursday night and the game comes on tonight and all of that. But this is in the context of, you know, opening ourselves up to God. And that requires some time with him. And he says to make his home, it means to settle down and live with us. Now, that's what it's about. This is about that to make his home in our hearts. In other words, to be welcome into our home. You know, he doesn't want just visiting rights, you know, to visit once a week on Sunday morning or something. And you know, that's important, but he wants a lot more than that. So he wants to be able to settle down into your life and make his home, be God with us. Y'all, to have every part of our life, you know, he wants to be invited into every private little part of our home and everything else. Now, how would you feel if you invited company over and you notice somebody was missing, you go back in and find they're in your bedroom, they're reading your checkbook or something, you know, they're well, you wouldn't feel very good about that. They're snooping into looking at stuff and all that. But see, it's not what we would expect. But see, we want to invite God into all of that, where we wouldn't want anybody else visiting in, and we wouldn't want anybody else to see. And see, he wants us to embrace him. See, and we, you know, we expect him to just come in and be the Lord of our life like that, and be everything to us. But see, when we open ourselves up to God, and we might think that if, you know, if I really got real with God, if I really opened up and just let him have every part of my life, and if I really surrendered every little corner and every little spot to my life, that he wouldn't want anything to do with me. It's not like he doesn't know it anyway, but I mean, it's just the way people start thinking. See, that's what we might think, that God's going to push us away. And really, the exact opposite is true. He's going to do you just like he did that prodigal son who came home. And the prodigal son thought, you know, I just need to be, I'll settle for being a hired servant with what I've done. But no, the father embraces him and gives him the best robe and puts everything on him. See, that's what God's going to do in your life when you let him make his home in your heart. And then he's going to, see, the love of God it then is going to grow deep into your life. And it says your roots will grow down into God's love and keep you strong. Once you discover what He really loves you unconditionally, in spite of everything that He knows about you, then you can just be yourself with God. And that's when you get strong. And all this whole phrase right here that's highlighted right now, it has a permanent, lasting results to it. When you let Jesus Christ make His home in you and you open up every part, your roots will grow deep and down into God's love, and that's what'll keep you strong. But, okay, so listen carefully to my next point, or you'll think I'm contradicting just what I said. But number two, y'all, He didn't play nice with hypocrites. See, we want that nice, sweet Jesus that never deals with our sin and all that. We want to keep in part in our lives where we can still be in control of our lives and everything. But Jesus didn't play nice with hypocrites. People. Now look, y'all, for people who are getting honest with God, like we just talked about, y'all, there's nothing you've ever done or ever will do that will stop Him from loving you and accepting you. But when you pretend and play games with God and try to live a lie and live in hypocrisy, that's what He doesn't like. And I want us to focus on a passage, just one verse right here in Matthew 23:33. You see, one day the whole bunch of religious leaders gathered together to attack Jesus, as they often did. And so they were coming at Him, and look, in the space of just a few verses, He calls them hypocrites 8 times. He looks them right in the face and calls them hypocrite, hypocrite, hypocrite. I mean, these were the powerful religious people of their day, the people that everybody thought was so righteous, and the ones that were living a lie. He said, you act like you're righteous, but inside you're like dead men's bones. And so, and then that was the gentle part. And then in Matthew 23:33, He says, He looks them straight in the eye and says, you're snakes. He says, you're sons of snakes. In other words, you're snakes producing more snakes. You're dangerous. Your venom is poisonous to people. You're poisoning the people around you. And then he looks them straight in the eye and he says, how will you escape the judgment of hell? He says, what makes you think you're not going to hell? Man, he didn't play nice with hypocrites. No, we don't want to be in the position to have God deal with us. Now, again, remember, y'all, when we get honest with God, when we own up to our sin and just get real with Him about it, y'all, there's nothing that He won't forgive. There's nothing that you can't sin a big enough sin that He can't forgive you. But that's for people who are getting real with Him. You know, that's for people who are really dealing with Him. Number three, as tough as He was with hypocrites, He was tender with children. Y'all, he was easily the most important person who ever lived. He had the most important purpose of anyone who ever lived, but he had time for the least of all people. Look at this in Mark 10:13-15. It says, one day parents brought their children to Jesus so He could touch and bless them. But the disciples scolded the parents for bothering Him. And when Jesus saw what was happening, He was angry with His disciples. He said to them, let the children come to Me. Don't stop them. For the kingdom of God belongs to those who are like children. I tell you the truth, anyone who doesn't receive the kingdom of God like a child will never enter in it. Wow. So the disciples scolded those parents. Man, He ain't got time for you and your kids. Man, we're with Jesus. You know, he's what's going on right now. He's the one that thousands of people are coming up to Him. He's the man. And look, and y'all get on out of here with that. But look at what Jesus said. He was angry with His disciples. Jesus was very human. He was 100% completely human, as well as being 100% completely God. But he lived a fully human life, and there were times where he got angry, but it was righteous anger. It wasn't selfish anger, the kind like I get. It wasn't the kind where you get just because you're annoyed and you're, you know, you're fleshly and carnal and all of that. But Jesus was angry about the right things. There are things we ought to be angry about right now. Y'all, there's a lot happening that God's people need to get angry about. You know, but Jesus was angry with his disciples. He says, let those children come to me and don't stop them. See, the politicians would, you know, they would let the press know they're going to be stopping at 10 o'clock and we're going to let the children come to us. So we got a photo op here for you all, you know, and this is all planned out. But it's got to be on my schedule because I'm a busy man. I'm very important. But Jesus, the most important person who ever lived with the most important purpose ever on this earth, he stops when they bring children to him. He took time out for them. I don't know of, and you know, I certainly don't know, have enough knowledge to know, but I don't know of any great leaders, you know, who took time for children like that. You know, that could ever be said about them, that they would, now their own children, and they would, like I said, they would have these opportunities where you get to see them on the news because the news has been told that he's going to be doing this today or she's going to be doing that. But not one of them who will just be walking and then a little kid runs out of the crowd and he stops. And I don't know of anything like that. Of course, there are safety reasons and all that. But he says, let the children come to me. He says, for the kingdom of God belongs to those who are like these children. You know one thing about children? They don't take life too seriously. And they don't try to have everything figured out up front before they decide something. You ever notice that about a kid? I mean, they don't think about everything. They see something, they want it, and they go for it. But he says, unless you become like children, like these children, you know, just decide you want Jesus and nothing's going to stop you from it. And you're not going to have to figure it out and weigh all the pros and the cons and weigh all your options and who's going to think what. He just wants us to come to him like a child. He says, I tell you the truth, anyone who doesn't receive the kingdom of God like a child will never enter it. See, if you think everything has to make sense to you, you know, it's Christianity, coming into a relationship with Jesus Christ. It's never going to make sense according to this world that a man died on a cross 2,000 years ago. But it's the most logical thing in the world if you think about who God is. And according to this book right here, he's a holy God. He's the creator of all that there is. And he is the God who is love, who would stop at nothing to act in love toward us. And so he sent his son into this world. But you got to just receive that and believe that. From the smartest person on the planet to the ones of us that are not that smart. We all come to him the very same way. But number four, he was tough enough to face execution. These mixed martial art fighters and football players and all that, I mean, they're tough. Y'all, they're nothing compared to Jesus. Amen. Look in John 19:30. It says, when Jesus had tasted it, he's hanging on the cross. And he's toward the very end. He said, I'm thirsty. And they gave him a drink that they gave to all the prisoners when they executed him like that. And it says, when Jesus tasted it, he said, it's finished. Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. See, he didn't have to come to this earth. He could have just taught us. And it would be the greatest teaching that there ever was. But we'd still be lost in our sins. I mean, he could have come and just done miracles. And he would have been the greatest person ever. And I think people would still be talking about him. But we'd still be lost in our sins. No, he went to the cross and died in our place and took the wrath of God that our sin deserved. And God placed it on him instead of us. And he was willing to do that for us. I don't know of anybody, anywhere, anytime in the history of the world who would have done that. But Jesus went through all the way. Remember, he told his disciples when they were about to arrest him, he said, "Don't you know I could send 10,000 angels right now? If I wanted to." But he said, "No. How will the scriptures be fulfilled? How can sin be paid for if I don't go through this?" And then he prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, you know, prayed and said, "Father, if there's any other way," you know, with sweat that was like drops of blood coming out of him. He faced the most cruel execution form that's been known probably to the human race. He faced it and he went through it for us. See, he was tough enough to face that. I was thinking about watching football. I love football. I love sports. You know, it's one. But you know, the thing about it is, we get excited about it. We get behind our team, and we feel like we're really competing out there with them. Y'all, we get into it. That we're so into it. We're so involved in it. But y'all, we're not playing football. We're watching football. You know, we're not participating in the game. And I fear that, you know, Christianity can be like that, where, you know, we talk about it, we agree with it, we think it's a great thing and all of that, but we're not, if we don't participate, see, we don't enter into that covenant with God, where he comes and makes his home in us. And he becomes the Lord of our life. And then we really enjoy Christianity. See, church and religion without Christ is dull and boring. Y'all, there are a lot of shows you can go to, and there's a lot of things you can do that are a lot more exciting than go to church if you don't have Jesus. You know, you, for one thing, a few extra hours of sleep probably do you good on a Sunday morning. But y'all, with Christ, it's everything. We want to be here. We want to worship him. We want to sense his presence. We want to share his presence among each other because it's real. You know, but you can watch it from the outside, or you can participate in it. But you can do that with Christmas, y'all. You can watch Christmas. You can, you know, watch the world celebrate buying all the gifts and everything. And we can even do that along with them. Or we can participate in it. Enjoy the greatest event that's ever happened. The most necessary thing that ever happened on this earth. That God came and forgave our sin. You know, without him forgiving our sin, you know, we're headed for eternity without God. That's into a place of, you know, it's described a lot of different ways in the Bible, but it's all bad. There's no party in hell. It got canceled due to fire. You know, there's none of that. It's all, you know, people say, "Well, I'll be with all my friends." No, yeah, no, you won't. You'll be alone. You'll be alone, and it'll be very, very dark. It'll be dark and lonely and cruel, because that'll be what you want, to be away from the presence of God. And it'll be a place of torment forever. But see, Christmas is really about Jesus came to get us out of that. That's what Christmas is about. Let's don't miss Christmas. So I want to invite you today, if you're listening online or you're here today and you've never really committed your life to Christ, you've never really asked Him to come into your life and make Him the Lord of your life where He's at home in your heart, where you live with Him, that's a lot different than religion. He wants you to live with Him. So He's inviting you today. So if you've never done that, now, right now, is the time. The Bible always says now is the time. Never says, hey, when you get home later or next week, I want you to think about this. He says, now is the time of salvation. So let's pray. Father in heaven, God, if there's anybody within the sound of my voice who's never invited you to come into their life, Lord, and experience the abundant life that Jesus Christ offers, the victory over this world and the things, the sin and things that destroy every good thing that you made for us to have. And so, Father, we pray that they would do it right now. And we thank you and praise you, dear God. In Jesus' name, amen.